Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 26th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to consider whether to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private this morning. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Thank you very much. Agenda item 2 for this morning's committee is consideration of the briefing paper prepared by the Auditor General on Scotland Colleges 2023. So I'm pleased to welcome our witnesses this morning. First of all, the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle, who's joined by Audit Director Mark McPherson. Good morning. Tricia Meldrum, who's a Senior Manager at Audit Scotland, and Douglas Black, who's an audit manager at Audit Scotland. You're all very welcome, and as you know, Auditor General, feel free to field any of the questions we've got to the most appropriate people on your team. Before we get to the questions, I would like to invite you to make a short opening statement.
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I'm pleased to present this briefing paper on Scotland's colleges. I know that the Committee will be aware that colleges are a valuable resource to students, their local communities and Scotland's employers. In Audit Scotland, we've consistently highlighted risks to the financial sustainability of Scotland's colleges, and these risks have increased further since our report last year. Grant funding from the Scottish Government through the Scottish Funding Council accounts for around 3/4 of the college's total income. The Scottish Government's funding for the sector has remained static in cash terms for 3 consecutive years, from 2021-22 to 23-24. And at the same time, like everywhere else, Scotland's colleges' costs have increased. The flat cash settlement, therefore, equates to a real terms reduction in funding of 8.5% over that period. My report notes that staff costs are the largest source of college expenditure and accounted for more than 2/3 of the sector's expenditure in the academic year 21-22. As with other public bodies, there is pressure on colleges to give pay rises that recognise high levels of inflation and that these costs, therefore, are likely to grow further. All this means that colleges are facing difficult choices around the workforce that they can afford to employ, the curriculum that they can provide, and the property estate they need to do so. Significant changes to how the college sector operates have been recommended by recent national reviews commissioned by the Scottish Government. These include the review by James Withers on the skills delivery landscape, in which he noted the important role that colleges play and urged the Scottish Government, therefore, to think creatively about how to secure the sustainability of the post-school skills delivery system. One of his recommendations was the establishment of a single national funding body to have responsibility for administrating and overseeing the delivery of all publicly funded post-school learning and training provision. Other relevant reviews have included the SFC's tertiary education and research review, which recommended to the Scottish Government that there should be more flexibility around how colleges are funded. The Hayward review of qualifications and assessment, which will have further implication for colleges' staff and students. We have recently seen the Scottish Government announce that there will be a new national model of public funding for all colleges, universities, apprenticeships and training. Convener, my briefing paper is at a high level. I did not aim to include specific recommendations to either the Government or the Funding Council, but it is clear, though, that there urgently need to build on their ongoing work to help colleges plan for change now and make best use of available funding so that it's sustainable in the future. My colleagues in Audit Scotland will continue to track the developments through the annual external audit of incorporated colleges and continue our engagement with key stakeholders. And as ever, Convener, we look forward to answering the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And as you say, it's a briefing and not a full report, which gives recommendations in it, but nonetheless contains some very stark warnings in it. And one of the warnings, and you've used the word risk and risks already, one of the warnings is a view that risks to the college sector's financial sustainability have increased since 2022. I wonder if you could give us an overview of what, in your view, those risks are.
Yeah, I'm happy to do that. Maybe bring Douglas in. As we set out in the paper, at a high level, the risks are increasing. I spoke in my introductory remarks about the nature of colleges' income and expenditure environment, that they are predominantly funded by grant funding from the Scottish Government through the Funding Council, and that other sources of income, as we spoke previously at sessions with the committee, have become more constrained as their ability to diversify, largely as a result of the pandemic, became tighter to do so. Exhibit 2 to today's paper sets out the scale of risks affecting Scotland's colleges. So I'll pause for a second and invite Douglas to talk to the committee on those and anything he wishes to elaborate on. Douglas.
Thank you. So two key issues, staffing and also the college sector's property estate. We know that staffing accounts for such a large proportion of colleges' expenditure. There are ongoing negotiations between College Employers Scotland and the trade unions for teaching and non-teaching staff. We're meeting them next week for an update. And it's not just salaries, of course, it's the pension costs which are geared to salaries. And we've seen a backlog of property maintenance funding over the years, with less capital funding by the Scottish Government than the college sector probably requires. Scottish Funding Council published a report a few years ago indicating that the sector required over £300 million of capital funding, and the funding by the government is well short of that. So, as Auditor General alluded to earlier, colleges need a good quality estate to provide a learning environment that's suitable both for staff and the students to deliver a quality curriculum that generates students which the economy needs.
Thank you. I mean, can I ask in stark terms, is insolvency a risk for any of the colleges in Scotland?
So that's not what we're seeing yet in the round, convener. You'll have seen from the paper, though, that colleges are very closely monitoring their financial position and have adopted what we regard as quite good practice in terms of their financial assessment, their future financial projections. The relationship that they have with the Funding Council through the financial returns that they have to make, the assumptions that they are using, has thrown up challenges. So colleges in Ayrshire and Glasgow have perhaps got the closest to setting out the scale of financial challenge that they are facing, that either might result in significant level of staff reduction through redundancy programmes, and potential viability issues, were there to be extreme scenarios. You know, if extreme scenarios fall across any public body, there would be viability issues. And indeed, you know, we've commented and discussed with the committee, the Scottish Government itself has projected that it has a significant gap in its public finances to deliver. So the viability of the college sector is challenged. What today's report is looking to set out, that to address that challenge, there needs to be a clear plan from the government, the Funding Council, about what the future provision of the model looks like. But it is, I think we have come closer in today's report than we have done in previous reports to identify colleges through their own work that are experiencing those real viability issues.
Thank you. I'm looking at Exhibit 2, one which is an illustration of significant areas of risk for colleges. One thing which isn't on there, which a couple of people have said to me who work in the sector, is European Social Fund money. And I think, as I understand it, there are some potential risks around the application of European Social Fund money, maybe even going back as far as the funding period 2011 to 2014, which I don't think have yet been signed off or audited even by the European Commission. So, it's certainly been pointed out to me that that's a potential risk as well that's maybe not stated in the report. I wonder whether you've got a view on that.
I'm maybe not able to say a great deal about it, convener. We haven't covered that in any depth in today's paper, although we are finalising our work on the audit of the Scottish Government consolidated accounts, and we'll be producing a Section 22 report on the consolidated accounts to bring to the committee before the end of the year, in which we will update on what's been a long-running theme of the government's compliance with the European Commission's requirements for the European Social Fund. The committee will recall that that has resulted in interruption penalties and so forth. How that relates to colleges, which were one of the vehicle bodies with which to administer the funding, we haven't covered in today's report. I'll maybe turn to colleagues if we have any further information we can share with the committee. If we don't, we can certainly come back to you in writing if we have more detail.
I'm afraid we don't have any more on that. The exhibit was really intended to be an illustration of the spectrum of challenges facing colleges, not an exhaustive list, but we can look back further into the ESF issue.
Thank you. I think that would be useful, and it would be helpful for the committee in considering its next steps. The Scottish Funding Council is obviously pivotal to this, and I think, as I read the briefing, it's the Scottish Funding Council that carries out an assessment of the sector's finances for each academic year. And one of the conclusions you reach is that there's an expectation of, I think the expression uses, an operating surplus that's considerably less. That's paragraph 10 of the briefing. Could you perhaps elaborate on what considerably less means?
Yeah, happy to do that, Convener. I'll bring colleagues in as well, maybe to set out for the committee a bit of the detail behind that. What I might say, first of all, is about the SFC's role relative to our own. The committee may recall that Audit Scotland had produced annual overviews of Scotland's colleges for many years. In recent years, we have moved instead to produce briefing papers, recognising that the Funding Council themselves, as well as being funders, are overseeing the sector as a whole and had been producing these analysis reports. They're due to do another one on the back of the 21-22 financial results of the colleges, but they're also going to incorporate the results of the financial return data that I mentioned a few minutes back, which will both set out a retrospective and a prospective look about how colleges' funding position is looking. We anticipate that this will be published over the course of the next few weeks, and expect that will really, you know, in addition to our own work, lay bare the challenges that Scotland's colleges are facing. In terms of the detail of the operating surplus, you mentioned at paragraph 10. I'll maybe ask if Mark wants to come in on that, or perhaps Douglas first of all.
Some detail we have that we didn't include in the report, it only became available to us afterwards, is that in 21-22, nine of the colleges returned an adjusted operating surplus, rather a deficit. Nine colleges returned a deficit in 21-22, and that compared with three colleges the year before. So that's really quite a sharp change in the complexion of the college's sustainability.
Can you remind us, that's three last year, nine this year, out of how many?
24.
Okay.
I think it reflects, Convener, the increasing challenge that the sector is facing. That, you know, so Exhibit 2, you've mentioned, sets out not an exhaustive list of financial challenges that the sector is facing, but as we know of Scotland's colleges, that they are led by people. You know, people provide services, staff costs therefore reflect the significant component of their operating expenditure. With a flat cash settlement environment that they've been in for the past three years, the sector has therefore had to fund pay awards over and above the settlement that they've been provided. Inevitably, that brings cost pressure and financial challenges.
But at that rate of increase of the number of colleges going into deficit, if that trend was to continue next year, then every single college would be in deficit, wouldn't it?
I'll perhaps not speculate until we've seen the SFC's analysis of the financial returns, but I think that will be a really important indication of not just the financial health of the sector, but hopefully, and then what comes next. You know, what guidance and support is the SFC and the government offering to colleges to help them plan for a sustainable future?
Right, thank you very much. On a similar theme and to develop some of these points, Graeme Simpson's got some questions to put to you. Graeme.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Convener. I'm just going to sort of continue on this theme, I think, and I've got some other questions. I mean, I think the report presents a pretty bleak picture, and I think and some of what you've said already highlights that. Did it when you were preparing this briefing? I accept it's just a briefing. Did you have discussions with the Scottish Funding Council?
Good morning, Mr. Simpson. Yes, we engage regularly with the government and the Funding Council. Colleagues may wish to say, perhaps Mark, to say a word about the nature of the engagement that we have throughout the year and indeed in the preparation of the paper.
Thanks. We tend to have regular, not necessarily scheduled specific dates, but we'll have regular engagement, particularly at key stages of the year, and particularly if we're preparing a piece of work like this. Douglas and the team will engage quite extensively around some of the detail and the data. But obviously, it is a briefing, and we know that they're doing their own work, so we tend to let them complete their work before we would then consider further.
The reason I ask is because I've been told that the Scottish Funding Council keeps its own risk register, and so they've got so basically a list of colleges that are doing well and some that are not doing so well, and that there are some that are listed as potentially being at risk of closing. My understanding is there are five of those colleges. I mean, is that something that you've heard?
So I'll ask colleagues if they've heard the detail of that. I think what I would say, Mr. Simpson, I think that probably feels like the right approach. You would expect the Funding Council, as the funder of colleges, and I know the importance of accountability arrangements. So, for example, the chief executive of the Funding Council is the accountable officer for the entirety of Scotland's colleges. So in governance terms and accountability, that feels like the right approach, that they would have a clear understanding based on their evaluation of the financial position and performance issues of Scotland's colleges, which colleges are performing well, which are experiencing financial health, or which are in financial difficulties. And again, I think that's consistent with their role to provide support and oversight of the college sector. In terms of the detail of how many colleges they would identify as experiencing financial challenges or otherwise, it's not something I've seen or can share with the committee, but again, I'll turn to colleagues if there's anything further we can add. Douglas.
Thank you. Not for 21-22 yet, because we're still waiting for the Funding Council's analysis of that, wrapping up its analysis of the financial projections. But in previous years, it's normally issued an annual analysis, a sort of state of the nation thing on the college sector. And I can just see in my mind's eye an appendix to that, which has a colour-coded list of the colleges, which captures the extent to which the Funding Council considers they may need support. And that can be support for a variety of reasons. It may be to do with financial matters, or it could be on governance issues, for instance.
Yes, I'm glad you mentioned the colour coding. That's what I'd heard as well, and I was told that those that are most at risk are coded black, and there are five such colleges.
I don't remember how many of them. I remember that the ones most at risk, as far as the council is concerned, are black. But that's going back to not 21-22, but 2021. So that's a few years ago now, and that's not necessarily a good indication of where colleges are at now.
So we probably need the current position, I think.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's going to be really important, whatever the detail of what the SFC set out, both in terms of their analysis of the accounts and the forward projections, that will give a much more up-to-date picture of where they're targeting their efforts.
Okay. I mean, how likely do you think it is that, you know, given them the cost pressures, industrial disputes are continually going on, likely to continue, you know, the wage pressures on colleges, how likely do you think it is that we're going to see compulsory redundancies in the sector?
Again, it's difficult to speculate whether it is or isn't likely, but the spectre of compulsory redundancies has been raised within colleges. So Ayrshire College, for example, maybe just to set a bit of context, Mr. Simpson, in the financial returns that the SFC asks colleges to provide, they give them, based on work that they do with the college's finance directors network, a range of assumptions with which to project their future financial health. Quite reasonably, I think, actually, what we've seen in Ayrshire College is that they've gone further than that. So they have used more challenging assumptions about what that might mean. So that college, in using it, whether you call it an extreme scenario or a more challenging scenario, have identified a threat to its financial viability. And we've also seen similar challenges in Glasgow Kelvin College, which it has also set out that it too might be facing real challenges that could require very real changes to its staffing arrangements and the possibility of compulsory redundancies. I don't think we're quite at that stage yet. I think that still would be predicated on almost a do-nothing further environment that stops short of additional funding or reform. So, but the possibility of it is being discussed within the sector.
Okay, I think colleagues will probably want to delve into the situation at Ayrshire College a bit more deeply, so I won't do that. One of your key messages in the briefing was that, and I'm just quoting, effective, affordable workforce planning is now a greater than ever priority and challenge for colleges. Can I ask what this means in practice? And given the reduction in college budgets that you've outlined, who's responsible? Is it colleges or the Scottish Government?
Put simply, it's going to be a shared endeavour. So, you know, the colleges work very closely with the Funding Council. I've mentioned the financial assumption arrangements. Douglas, you might want to elaborate on a bit more of this, but colleges themselves will need to have a clear financial plan, business plan, what that means in terms of performance, their offer of curriculum to current and prospective students. We've also mentioned this morning, Mr. Simpson, about the estate that colleges operate from. That's also part of their financial plan. So all of these factors have to be considered in the round. But at the heart of that will be, how do they intend to deliver services for the people that work for Scotland's colleges? If I may, convener, perhaps just, and I look forward to speaking with the committee about it over the course of the next few weeks, but we published a briefing paper on the Scottish Government's workforce arrangements this morning, which similarly makes recommendations about the need for effective long-term workforce planning to support good quality service provision at a time of financial challenge. But I'll pause for a minute. I guess Douglas might want to say a bit more about workforce planning in the college sector.
Thank you. A key factor will be the number of learning credits which each college is expected to deliver, and that will be geared to the staffing complement that's required to provide that amount of learning activity across the range of courses, the number of students on the variety of courses and so on, and the pitch will vary across the college sector depending on local circumstances and student demand. A key document for each college is a shared outcome agreement, which is basically the contract between the college and the funding council for the type and quantity of college activity during the course of the year. And that's also the basis for which the college's performance is tracked by the funding council as well. And the number of credits actually delivered by the college is very closely monitored by the funding council as well. So there's a lot of interaction between the funding council and each individual college, both in terms of planning ahead for the years to come, what happens during the course of the year, retrospective tracking of performance. But essentially, it all comes down to, is there enough funding to pay for the staffing required to deliver the quantity, the type of learning activity in the college?
Yeah, and I read your report from this morning. It's extremely relevant to what we're discussing. There's just one more thing I want to ask, if that's okay, convener. And it's about arms-length trusts, which are called in the college sector, arms-length foundations, which were set up in 2014. I just wonder, I know you've done some work on these in the past, but I didn't see any mention of them in this briefing. I just wonder whether you've been doing any sort of up-to-date monitoring of the money that's in these foundations. What it's being used for, is it going from the foundations into back to colleges, and are colleges moving money into foundations? You know, just where are we with this?
Yeah, you're right, Mr. Simpson. We haven't covered arm's length foundations in today's briefing paper, but we have in earlier reports over the past few years updated on primarily the extent of funds still held in arm's length foundations. So I may need to refresh my memory, or colleagues can help me out, but in general terms, the extent of funding has dwindled significantly from what it once was. You remember the history of arm's length foundations. This was a mechanism with which the college sector was able to continue to access reserves that they had built up before they became central government bodies, and this was the vehicle with which to do so. Not all colleges had them. Some had, for those that did, some had quite significant balances, but the trajectory has been one of, as we probably would have expected, that over the years they have been used for the purposes, the quite clear purposes that they're intended. If we have any further detail, I don't think we do at hand today, we can come back to it, but it wasn't a feature of this year's work.
So do you think it would be possible to get a sort of up-to-date picture?
Yeah, very possible. I think what we might do is await the SFC's publication, where they will be analysing the in more detail the annual report and accounts of the college sector. If that doesn't provide detail, then which when it's published over the next few weeks, is something we can look at, and if we get more information, we can share that with the committee.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. That's very helpful. So, sorry, just for confirmation, that's something that we expect before the end of November to be produced by the Scottish Funding Council.
Yeah, I think I need to. It's due round about this time of year, convener. Actually, I don't think we have a precise date for publication yet.
Okay, you can't be held responsible for when the Scottish Funding Council publishes its report, are we? I think we understand that. I'm going to now invite Willie Coffey to put some questions to you, and Sharon Dowie may drop in and out of this section as well. But Willie, first of all, to you.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Auditor General. I want to just open up a little bit of discussion on the Ayrshire College commentary that's in your briefing. Of course, there's a almost like a kind of doomsday scenario potential forecast in there that would worry everyone in the sector, it would worry everyone in Ayrshire, but the college principal has subsequently ruled that forecast out and has not adopted that forecast, and she's written to members to clarify that. But could you just give us a little bit of flavour of where do these forecasts come from, and who scrutinises their viability? Do they follow criteria set by the SFC? And why are all the colleges not doing what Ayrshire and Glasgow have done?
Yeah, I'm happy to start on this, Mr. Coffey. And maybe Tricia might want to say a bit more about, I think, as you allude to, just how realistic or plausible the scenario is. I think the first thing I would say, I think it's a, without wishing to alarm people, and I think there is a risk of that, and I'm quite sure, you know, from the community of Ayrshire that the college serves, that they might well be alarmed by a projection that suggests there are doubts about its viability. But in terms of, you know, setting out about what a challenging scenario might be, I think it is important that that is clear. There's transparency about the scale of issues that Scotland's colleges are facing. So the assumptions that I mentioned a few minutes ago, there are base assumptions that the SFC and the College Finance Directors operate that sets out how they should be used to inform future financial projections. Some colleges have used more challenging assumptions where it relates to information that's available for their circumstances. Again, I think that's an appropriate thing to do, because, you know, so it develops an assumption for local circumstances. It is the case, though, that this was quite a far-out assumption that would be extremely challenging and perhaps more unlikely. But in terms of risk management and future financial projections, it's the kind of thing we'd expect all public bodies to be doing. So whilst it's not operating as a core assumption, it's one that you should have a plan of how to deal with. If anything we've learnt, if I may just to digress for a second from the pandemic, is that we need to prepare for quite extreme scenarios, how we might deal with it. So that's the general background to that, Mr. Coffey, but I'm going to pass to Tricia just to say a bit more about the use of assumption and development of it, and then the college's further view on how applicable that one is. Tricia.
Thank you. So all colleges prepare their response for SFC, which is, and their assumptions are things that are based around sort of Scottish Government spending review, and the assumptions that you would take from that, from the information that's available around that. The Finance Directors Network have also done their own work around different sets of assumptions that makes assumptions around things like energy costs and what these are going to look like. So some of the trends in the costs that you would expect the college sector to potentially be looking at. So it's those assumptions that have underpinned the two different types of analysis. The SFC will be doing further analysis when they see all of their returns. That's one of the things we're expecting to see towards the end of November, around how that looks. And I think the other thing to say around the Ayrshire example is that the figure around potential loss of staff is based on that pessimistic set of assumptions, but also all the savings having to come from staffing. So if all of the savings came from staffing, that's what it would potentially look like. But obviously, there's other options that they could be exploring. And the council, the college has been doing a lot of work to look at the risks and how they manage those risks and how they mitigate those risks. So the information we have is that they feel that was quite an extreme scenario, and that's not the position that they're actually in.
Thanks for that. What I'm trying to get, I suppose, is that in Ayrshire, are they a bit more pessimistic down there about the future, or had the other colleges embraced this similar scenario, would they have come up with the same forecasts and projections as Ayrshire are doing? I'm trying to kind of burrow in to try and find the answer to that. You said that Ayrshire and Glasgow did this and none of the others did it. So had the others, should the others do this similar level of forecasting, would we arrive at a similar picture, do you think?
I think perhaps all we can offer is maybe. Maybe that's what you're seeing, but that Ayrshire have done so, we think is a good thing. You know, that they were, they are exploring, and that they've shared it with their board of governance. So there's visibility of the scale of the challenges that college is facing, but also the sector more widely. I mean, I don't think, while that extreme scenario might not come to pass, I don't think it should mask the fact that there are really live viability issues for the sector in the round that that has to result in a clear path we don't quite yet have.
And in terms of the Funding Council reviewing these forecasts, Stephen, when is that going to happen, and when will we get some kind of clarity or even certainty in this matter?
So I think that's the publication we're waiting for over the next few weeks, Mr. Coffey, that should set out the Funding Council's up-to-date view of the financial health of the sector and the analysis of the accounts. Clearly, that'll be a very important statement of where resources will be targeted and what kind of support the Funding Council can offer individual colleges.
Uh-huh. My last query on this issue for Ayrshire, convener. Auditor General, you still cited in the residual PFI payments that Ayrshire College are still making. As I understand it, they still pay £2 million a year to pay off the PFI investment from 23 years ago or so, I think it's 23 years ago. Is that still contained within the college's financial projections and would be part of this scenario, this forecast scenario going forward?
Again, I'll invite colleagues who've got more detail on that, Mr. Coffey, but certainly any payments and PFI forecasts would be captured as part of the annual audit of Ayrshire College. So those will be set out in the college's financial forecasts and their annual report and accounts, and would have been subject to audit this year. Beyond that, whether there's any more fundamental plans about the management and use of the PFI, I'll maybe just check in if there's any more detail.
We know the matter is flagged in the annual audit report for 2021-22, but we haven't looked into capturing the detail on that for this briefing, I'm afraid.
It would have to form part of these projections, surely, if it's a £2 million burden that they face going up to 2025. It would still have to be captured within this scenario as well, I would imagine.
Yes, you're right, it would have to be captured in the scenario, unless there's a specific assumption around the PFI. I think, as we spoke to the committee about over the past few weeks, there are, as we're approaching the era of the end of some of the original PFIs, that requires careful management consideration about how the public sector, including colleges, will plan to use and manage former PFI assets as they're brought back into the public sector estate. So I think it's an important thing for both the college and the SFC to take a view on about what that means for future financial projections and health.
And Ayrshire College, finally, is the only college in Scotland that has a PFI liability still live, I think.
I'm not sure.
You're right.
It is.
Ayrshire's the only one that kind of still carries a PFI burden, as I understand it, and that's been had a substantial impact on the college over many years. But thank you very much for answering those questions, Auditor General.
Thanks, Willie. I think Sharon's got a supplementary question in this area too. Sharon.
Thank you. It's just a quick one. It's just to see how accurate the forecasts have been following the Scottish Funding Council assumptions compared with what the actual figures are. I know you said earlier on that six colleges come back with a deficit. So I'm just wondering whether Ayrshire College is right to go in and do the pessimistic view and how accurate all the colleges' figures are following SFC guidelines.
Yeah, good morning, Deputy Convener. So I think, as I've said this morning, I think it is the right thing to do. I think all colleges and all public bodies should be using a range of scenarios to stress test their financial health as to and how they would cope with. Inevitably, it is a forecast. So does it then mean that that is what the financial results have been? Probably not. And I think given some of the variables that are set out in Exhibit 2, there's a range of factors that will influence, you know, the eventual financial outturn of a college over and above what can potentially be quite narrow scenarios. But I don't think it should detract from the fact that Scotland's colleges are facing real financial pressure. So whether it's marginally consistent with the forecast or it's wildly out, difficult choices are going to have to be made to deliver a sustainable college provision for students, for staff who work in the communities they serve. Mapping, if picking up rightly, if you want, mapping exactly what the forecast was to the outturn is something that the SFC and the college should be looking at. And again, I think if we're inclined to do so, and we can have a further look at this to say, well, what was the forecast and then what was the outturn, we probably need to go back through a number of years' worth of reports to do that. But that information is publicly available.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks. Before we leave the Ayrshire College doomsday scenario, I mean, if they're talking in their pessimistic projection about a potential 70% reduction over 5 years in staffing, and it operates, as I understand it, on three campuses, Kilwinning, Kilmarnock and Ayr, I mean, would that suggest that they would just consolidate on one campus?
I think those would be choices for the board and the SFC convener about how they would organise themselves to deliver a service. As we talked about with in our infrastructure briefing paper, the use of the estate really matters. It'll be as alongside costs, and as Douglas has mentioned already, the estate has many millions of pounds of backlog maintenance that also needs to be factored into future plans. But the specifics of Ayrshire College and how it delivers its service will be up for the board and the SFC of that college to determine how that best meets service requirements alongside their financial health.
But it hasn't developed that that picture as part of its scenario in its submissions to the Funding Council, for example?
Not that we're aware of the detail of that, Convener. I think that's something that is probably something that the college would be best placed themselves to comment upon about how it would respond to, as Trish has mentioned, quite pessimistic scenarios, which they have said since their use of that scenario, that's not one that they're operating to with great certainty. But ultimately, it'll be for the college to determine their service model provision.
But in the briefing, in paragraph 14, you finish with the clause regarding the 70% cut of staffing over a five-year period at Ayrshire College. You describe that as a scenario in which it could no longer function. Yep. Is it a scenario in which it could no longer function in its present form, or is the full stop after function? It would be...
Correct. In its present form. So, you know, whether it had three campuses, if it had to lose 70% of its staff, then it wouldn't be able to deliver the model of service courses that it currently exists. So, I mean, to take that scenario to an extreme, there could still be an entity with that name, but not one that you would recognise or ability to serve its students in the way that it currently does.
Okay, thank you. We've mentioned a few times the college estate, and I know Colin Beattie's got some questions on that. So, Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Over the years, I think the college estate has come up repeatedly in your reports. And it's not just the college estate, it seems to be across the board in the whole public sector. Maintenance and so forth has fallen well behind. And looking at the figures for the college sector, it really does seem that, according to your briefing in 2022, capital funding for college sector was 321 million short of requirements for life cycle and backlog maintenance. That's a lot of bucks. That's a lot of bucks. These issues have been highlighted now so often. Is there any progress towards tackling this? Is there any real understanding and management of this?
It's a hugely significant issue, Mr. Beattie, there's no question of that. So to reiterate some of the numbers around this, that we have over £300 million of backlog maintenance. And as we allude to in the report, some of that will be compounded by the identification of rack concrete deficiencies that have been noted in...
Which, of course, was another question I was going to ask apologies. You, but if you've got an answer at the moment, that would be great.
I'll save that thought for a minute then. But in terms of the scale of backlog maintenance, it's yet another financial pressure on Scotland's colleges so that they can find a mechanism with which to safely deliver learning for their students. To bring this in from another angle, if I may, for a second, 9 out of 10 students in Scotland say that they are happy with the service that they get from Scotland's colleges. That's very impressive, given the scale of challenge that is evident in Scotland's colleges. But they need to have a safe learning environment with which to pursue their studies. And in operating with £300 million of maintenance requirements puts at risk the ability for the sector to have a safe environment with which to provide people. So much work to be done. All the things that we do know further, so as we mentioned in the report, the SFC has developed an infrastructure strategy which will look to help the sector address some of their requirements for infrastructure. And we're awaiting a publication of an infrastructure delivery plan, again over the next few weeks, that should set out in more detail how the SFC and Scotland's colleges will work to provide that safe environment.
Now, looking at your report again, the SFC has made available £4.7 million for health and safety, and they've got bids of about £20 million. How's that going to work?
So you're right, there's something of a mismatch. Maybe ask Tricia just to set out in a bit of detail how that fund is operating and how the SFC is prioritising. Tricia.
Don't have a huge amount more detail around that, just that the SFC is looking to identify what are the kind of biggest priorities in terms of the biggest, I guess, the riskiest areas that are most in need of funding. And then RAC is then obviously appearing on top of that as well as a different issue. So yeah, it's very much part of the pressures there, but that pot of money is not going to address the scale of the challenges that are facing the college sector. I think just to add a wee bit on other things that the SFC are doing around supporting the sector. So we know that as part of their infrastructure strategy, they're doing some work with colleges around looking at the baseline condition of the college estate and the infrastructure. And that's due, they're hoping to publish that information sort of late spring. So that, again, adds to... This, at the moment, there's these kind of very immediate health and safety issues and challenges. This will be a much broader look at what's the whole state of the estate, and then use that information to build on the strategy to develop the infrastructure investment plan, and that's due autumn 2024, and that'll be a 10-year plan for 2024 to 34, and part of that is around how that funding, how it will actually be funded to deliver on the strategy. So getting into what are the potential solutions to making sure that the estate is fit for purpose and addressing this backlog.
It all sounds like a bit of deja vu. Haven't we been through all this before over the years? I mean, I've sat in this committee now for 13 years, and you know, every time colleges come up, the maintenance backlog comes up, and someone's going to prioritise doing some sort of assessment as to, you know, for allocating funds for the most urgent ones and all the rest of it. This sounds like it's exactly the same again.
So you're right, there is some familiarity with this topic, Mr. Beattie. It's not unique to colleges, I should say. We've reported in other sectors, NHS, for example, that it too is facing hundreds, I think over £1 billion actually, of backlog maintenance. Financial context is everything here. So that, you know, whilst, you know, your memory stretches back a number of years, just looking at the years timeframe we cover in today's report, the 3 years worth of flat cash settlement, plus dealing with above inflation or above financial settlement pay awards, inevitably requires colleges to make choices. So if they've had to fund pay, it meant that what we're seeing is they've not been able to support backlog maintenance requirements and other pressures. All of that requires prioritisation and trade-off. So I think it's important to recognise that the SFC have set out a strategy and will be setting out a delivery plan on how they will be supporting the sector address this. But yeah, there's important work to be done here.
And presumably you'll be taking an interest into what comes out of this.
Yeah, quite. I think you're probably hearing today there's a number of important reports awaited from the SFC and the government about how they will be assessing the financial viability and helping colleges prioritise to deliver to a sustainable platform for the future. But there are a lot of risks to be addressed.
Coming to the concrete, reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete, how's the college sector in terms of that? Do we have any knowledge? Has there been an assessment carried out?
We do. So I think I'm right in saying, and again, colleagues can keep me right in this, that there are three colleges in Scotland that have identified that they have RAC in their buildings, which are Dundee and Angus, Glasgow, Clyde and Edinburgh College. The extent to which that has interrupted learning and plans that the sector have in place will be held by individual colleges. I think there's been some communication and discussion between the Minister and the Education Committee on how this was being managed and reported. So that work is in progress, Mr. Beattie, but I think it goes back to your earlier point that dealing with £300+ million of backlog maintenance and now having to potentially find additional resource to make buildings safe to address RAC concrete, it's just another financial pressure that the sector has to accommodate.
Okay, move on slightly to something different. COVID-19 restrictions are obviously no longer in place. Is there any evidence that colleges are pursuing non-SFC funding sources, you know, generating money from commercial activities and so on? Because that was the great cry before COVID, that they were going to generate all this money. Has that happened?
Yeah, I'm going to bring in Douglas to say a wee bit more about this, but your memory's right that the intention was that colleges in previous years would have been able to diversify, to bring in other sources of income, to lessen their reliance upon SFC grant funding. But as we reported in previous briefing papers on the sector, inevitably COVID-19 had a very significant interruption upon that, especially the nature of some of the diversification of income would require face-to-face learning to support that. So we've noted in the paragraph 22 that we're still in a scenario that grant funding is around three quarters of the sector's income. Other sources such as tuition fees, education contracts, and examples such as catering tend to be the sources with which other income for colleges can be generated. The extent to which that is returning to pre-pandemic levels is something that we will await the detailed analysis of in the accounts. I'm not sure it's going to be the panacea, Mr. Beattie, in terms of that will be the answer to the college's financial pressures. I think it will help if they're able to pursue that diversification. But in terms of realigning their financial health, I think it's going to be more fundamental in terms of the grant funding that they receive from the SFC.
I suppose coming back to what something Graeme Simpson touched on with the ALFs, are colleges making use of the ALFs to channel their commercial income into, which was the original intention, to keep it out of the public purse?
So I think, as Douglas said, we haven't looked at in any detail in today's briefing about the transactions that are flowing through the arm's length foundations. Again, if we have more detail on that, we can share that with the committee, but it's not something I have to hand today.
It would just be interesting to know if there was anything happening there. I guess the other big question is, and it's one we've really everybody's touched on to some extent, there's a real terms reduction of 8.5% in college funding from 21-22 to 23-24. Clearly that's going to have a huge impact. You've already highlighted some of the risks in terms of salaries and so on coming down the line. What constraints do you think it's going to put in the colleges? Just as a general question.
I think it's going to be hard for any organisation to sustain the status quo with that level of funding reduction while their expenditure is increasing. So in that context, I think what we're already seeing, you know, your line of questioning in terms of backlog maintenance would be one element of it. And as colleges themselves are already doing through their viability assessments, what does that mean for their staffing contingent? My paper that came out on the Scottish Government's workforce, for example, there's a really telling statistic in that, where other parts of the Scottish the devolved public sector have grown in terms of staffing numbers. Scotland's colleges haven't. They have fallen in terms of numbers. So I'm reluctant to speculate in terribly much more detail, Mr. Beattie, but I think it's safe to say that where your funding doesn't match your expenditure, it will require difficult choices, and that will be about curriculum content, the extent of provision, the number of staff that's available, quality of buildings and so forth, all really difficult challenges.
I mean, I would like to think that 8.5% wasn't pulled out of a hat, and that there was some anticipation that colleges would be able to cope with that level of decrease in funding, and that they'd be able to find efficiencies or different ways of delivering, which would correspond. Do we have any information on that?
I think if you're asking to look to the future a little bit, I think about, you know, the extent of colleges' awareness of this. Colleagues might want to say a bit more about the funding environment, the extent to which the SFC supports colleges in terms of its financial planning. We might also want to develop the what comes next. I mentioned in my introductory remarks that there have been a number of reviews of the sector looking to the future about how this can become a sustainable model, a sustainable sector to deliver high quality education, skills training for people for the future. One of the changes that we know about that the SFC has asked for is a new funding distribution model that gives more flexibility to colleges to help them plan for the future. I think that will be one of the early signs of more flexibility in terms of funding. But until we've got wider clarity, Mr. Beattie, about really the government's intentions about what we'll do with a variety of recommendations, it's a remaining challenge to be addressed. I'm going to pause for a minute just to see if colleagues may wish to set a bit more detail about the financial projection over a more than a 12-month period.
I would expect the Scottish Funding Council's work looking at colleges' projections to take staffing issues into account. But as Stephen said, more widely, there are other things going on. We've been engaging with the Funding Council and the Scottish Government, as we usually do. So we know that the Government's thinking very hard about how to address the recommendations of a range of recent national reviews. The review by James Withers of post-school skills delivery, the review by Professor Hayward of qualifications arrangements, the Funding Council's own review a couple of years ago, which also looked into the sustainability of the college sector. So rather than taking these reviews separately, the government's trying to look at the whole package of reviews and the implications that they have for the purpose and principles for what the college sector and the university sector is actually trying to deliver and achieve, and how that will all be managed and organised. So it's work in progress at the moment.
Okay, just one last question, which I find a bit of an anomaly, is about the differences in financial years. You know, the Scottish Government obviously has a budget that works on the financial year April to March. The colleges are funded within the academic year, August to July. To what extent do you think that causes any difficulty to the colleges? I mean, it sounds a bit daft in some ways.
I think it's a known complexity, I would describe it as, but it brings further financial challenges, because what you effectively have is that in funding an academic year, it straddles two financial years. So if there are significant changes from one financial year to the next, that could impinge upon the academic year funding environment as well. I'm not sure if there's any intention to change that. I think it's a factor that is known, and it's a complexity that's allowances are made for, Mr. Beattie. But again, it's potentially an area that the SFC are better placed to comment on than I am.
Is it just a historic anomaly?
I'd need to go back and check about the timing of it. I think Scotland's colleges are the only sector that I'm responsible for auditing that doesn't operate to a March financial year end. Their financial results, which I think is right, reflect the way that they deliver their services, which, you know, runs from an August to July year end. And for me, that feels it's the right way for presenting their financial results, but inevitably it's at odds with how the rest of the funding environment operates. So I think it's just, I'm not sure I would make too much of it. I think it's just, but it's an additional complexity that the SFC has to manage.
But surely it's not a necessary complexity. You can still have your academic year and your financial year. They don't have to coincide.
Yeah, I'll ask Mark to say a bit more. He's got some of the additional history behind this.
Yeah, I suspect the financial year for colleges, I mean, it's set in legislation, but I think it's also tied to, you know, them being before they were public bodies as such. So it's a long-standing historical thing. I think you would need to explore, or the SFC and the government would need to explore with colleges whether it would be beneficial for them to have to change their financial year if all their planning is currently done around the academic year. So there could be benefits for the colleges in having a financial settlement that aligns with their own financial year and their own planning.
Do we know that there's any thought to do this? To look at this?
I do have some vague recollections from several years ago now when we engaged with the college sector, but it's not something I've revisited recently.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Drawing towards the close of this session, but I know that the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dow, has got a number of questions to put. So, Sharon, over
to
you.
Thank you, morning. Paragraph 25 states that the Scottish Government announced in June 23 that it plans to take over national responsibility for skills planning, and that there will be a new national model of public funding for all colleges, universities, apprenticeships and training. Do you know what timescales the Scottish Government is working to for this?
I'll ask colleagues if we have any further detail on that, Deputy Convener.
No, we don't.
I think
that's a short and sweet answer.
We've been speaking to the Scottish Government about it. They haven't given us a timescale for how their work will pan out on this.
Right, OK. Right, thank you.
If I may, Deputy Convener, I think that's... The committee will recall that we produced a report on skills planning arrangements in Scotland. My memory's about to fade me, but I think it was early 2022 or 21. And again, identified some of the areas for improvement about how Scotland's skills system was operating. This has one of been the impact of some of those findings and recommendations. I think, as Douglas mentions, we don't quite yet know the detail about, you know, when all that's going to come to play. But what we want to see, not just the date, but actually what that then means in practice about how it will deliver better outcomes for people who are using and rely upon the skills system.
Okay, thanks. Have you had the opportunity to consider the SFC's new funding distribution model and guidance for academic year 23-24? And if so, could you provide us with any further details on that?
So it's something we'll be turning our attention to. We haven't considered that as part of today's paper, but very clearly it will be part of our work and future reporting that we do on the college sector.
Okay. In paragraph 30, it says, while recognising the role of college leadership teams in managing their finances, it is also critical for the Scottish Government to work with the Scottish Funding Council during academic year 23-24 to support colleges in planning for change now and making the best use of available funding. So is there any evidence to demonstrate that the Scottish Government is working with the Scottish Funding Council to support colleges?
Yes, I think there is. There is strong evidence that the Funding Council is aware of the issues that the college sector is facing. I guess there are a number of components to this. So there are well-established arrangements with which the SFC works with and supports colleges. We've seen that through their analysis of the accounts, their performance information, the shared outcome agreements, the financial forecasts, and the risk management arrangements that underpin all of that. We think it is an important development that there's going to be additional funding distribution models and more flexibility that's intended around that. What we're really setting out in today's paper is that there's still work to build upon that the SFC is and government is working with colleges to deliver a sustainable future for the college sector. The scale of financial challenges facing the sector are significant. So using that underpinning will help, but what comes next in terms of the detail of the plan to deliver the financial health of the sector is what we're looking to see.
Okay, so you feel they're doing enough to support them just now?
I think that feels like quite a broad question, if I may, Deputy Convener, that there is the scale of risk and challenge facing the sector is significant. And I think, as we've talked about already, that even allowing for that support that's already in place, that some colleges are forecasting that the way they deliver services at the moment might not be sustainable. So to say that enough is being done is probably a judgment that I wouldn't be making today, just given the scale of challenges that remain to be addressed.
OK, and a query, just going back on to the beginning of the report. It says 19 colleges are classed as incorporated and are public bodies, and also says they are not permitted to retain reserves at the end of their financial year. So my question would be, does that put them at a disadvantage to colleges that are unincorporated? And is there anything that can be done? Maybe brings it back to Graeme Simpson's point on ALFs. I'm just kind of thinking, if they're not able to carry over any excess funding at the end of the year, then they risk spending it or wasting the money at the end of the year, spending it on things that they don't need to spend it on. So is that getting looked at? Is that something that can be done to allow them to carry over extra funding?
Maybe Mark might want to say a bit more about this. There is a great deal of history with the college's funding environment and their ability to retain reserves and much discussion, and indeed the predecessor committee took evidence on colleges' inability to retain reserves and what that means. I think a couple of aspects to it, Deputy Conveners. I don't think they're in competition as colleges between for the incorporated relative to the unincorporated colleges. But as with almost all Scottish Government bodies, they don't hold reserves. The Scottish Government themselves is only recently with the Scotland Reserve in a position that it can use that as a vehicle with which to support its financial planning. But I don't think there's any plans to revert to a situation where colleges can hold reserves. If there are, that would be a matter for the government and the Scottish Funding Council. I'll stop for a minute. Mark might want to say a bit more about some of the history and where it goes next.
I don't want to get into too many technicalities. I mean, essentially, that is what led to the creation of the arm's length foundations, was that limitation, that constraint on colleges. My recollection, and it's a few years since I was deep in the college sector, was that the funding, as the Auditor General alluded to in the ALFs, was dwindling, was reducing over time. And it is worth bearing in mind that when it is in an ALF, there's no guarantee that the college will get it back, because the purposes for which they were instated was not just for colleges, it's for educational purposes throughout the year. That was a very important part of how they remained independent and how it could be used as a vehicle if there were funds to be deposited.
And just one final question, just going back to Exhibit 2. One of the significant areas of risk is the investment required to achieve public sector net zero targets, especially in relation to the college estate. And it won't just affect the college estate. Obviously, there's a lot of old buildings in there, historical buildings. Has the Scottish Government done anything to actually cost how much this is going to be, to make sure that they're actually giving the required funding to the college estate to get them to net zero?
So we're expecting to see the infrastructure delivery plan that's imminent will set out how net zero will be achieved by Scotland's colleges. I think that has to be a core plank of that strategy and delivery plan.
OK, I said we were in the final approach, but I've got an indication from Willie Coffey that he wants to ask a question, so I'm going to bring Willie back in.
Thank you, Convener. Just to follow up on the questions that Colin had posed on the potential for commercial income, but it was really to ask about what the college's relationship, if any, with the European Union is now and going forward. You'll know, Stephen, that they used to benefit from European Social Fund money and so on, so it's to ask, was that ever replaced in any way, shape or form, and what's stopping Scotland's colleges from continuing to develop, even if it's a commercial relationship now, with the European Union?
I'm not sure I have the detail to best answer your question, Mr. Coffey, on colleges' ability to best make arrangements following what soon be the end of European social funding arrangements. You'll know, and I know the committee is familiar with aspects of the successor arrangements following the UK's exit from the European Union in terms of levelling up funding and so forth. How that relates to colleges, I think we probably need to know a bit more detail, perhaps come back to the committee in writing on.
OK, thank you.
OK, thank you. Two quick final questions from me. One is, and again, it's not something which I think is in this briefing especially, but it's something which has been a recurring theme in previous briefings and reports, including the Section 22 report into South Lanarkshire College. And that was a question about the regional board structure and whether or not that represents a sensible part of the whole governance landscape, or whether it's frankly surplus to requirements. I just wonder whether you've got any reflections on that question.
Yeah, so in today's paper, convener, we set out a couple of relevant points to this. One is that there have been some changes to the college sector since we last reported, with some amalgamations in the University of the Highlands and Islands, which was one of the components of the SSC's findings from 2 or 3 years ago that related to this general theme of mergers and amalgamations. The other two aspects of that were in respect of the regional structures in Lanarkshire and Glasgow, which SSC's view were that needed to change, weren't delivering for what was originally intended. So we've not seen or not aware of any timeline or further plans for those regional structures in Glasgow or Lanarkshire. I think it's probably a question that the SFC will be best placed to update on about how they intend to progress that.
Thank you, and it will be part of the committee's considerations of next steps about whether we seek further evidence from organisations, including the Scottish Funding Council. And my final question was very much tying in with the final conclusions of the report, where you remind us that the Scottish Government's three missions are equality, opportunity and community. And in paragraph 28, you conclude a significant reduction in a college's range of courses, student capacity or its closure altogether could have an unequal impact on students from more deprived areas. I wonder whether you could elaborate that point a little bit for us.
Yeah, very, very happy to do so, Convener, actually. And I think a couple of threads to that. One is the undoubted benefit that Scotland's colleges provide to students and their communities. I'm sure the committee will be familiar with a report that was produced earlier this week by the Fraser and Vallander Institute, which set out the economic benefit that Scotland's colleges provide of £52 billion of students over their working life who've gone through the college sector. We also know from analysis about the relative prevalence of people from disadvantaged backgrounds who are more likely to go to Scotland's colleges than they are to other education spheres. Putting all that together, if there's going to be a disruption based on the financial position of Scotland's colleges, it was clear from the supporting evidence that people from more deprived backgrounds would more likely to experience disadvantage if there were to be a disruption to the provision of college learning that's on offer.
Okay, well, thank you. On that note of sharp realism, we will conclude this morning's evidence session. But, Auditor General, can I thank you and your team of Mark McPherson, Tricia Meldrum and Douglas Black for the evidence that you've given us this morning. As I say, it will be for the committee to consider what its next steps are. But I think the briefing has been an extremely valuable brief insight into the state of finances, especially in Scotland's colleges. So can I thank you for that? And I'm now going to move the committee into private session.